Ok, allora abbiamo visto in realtà degli algoritmi, in realtà noi ne abbiamo visti due, poi ci sarà una pagina finale in cui io faccio una sorta di riassuntino. La famiglia dell'inversione è quella della trasposizione, no? Perché può essere ridondante, non ridondante, con sfruttamento meno della ridondanza, ma alla fine o uso, diciamo, l'inversione o la trasposizione. E abbiamo parlato di algoritmo di Jacobiano. Sorry. Ok. So you are the only one today, and you are just back to your colleague. So I was only looking at the faces of the former class. So I started in Italian. Okay, we saw up to now our let me say two kind of algorithms based on the inversion of the Jacobian. Pseudo-inversion is a kind of inversion, so inversion of the Jacobian and transposition of the Jacobian. We can apply it for a square or a redundant robot with or without exploiting redundancy, but the concept is more or less the same. They had in common the use of the analytical Jacobian. Now, analytical Jacobian means time derivative of the orientation representation. And we already noticed that time derivative of orientation representation does not have a physical meaning. So, what does it mean? Well, it means that I should spend some time in trying to talk and understand the orientation energy. Okay. And we will see also some animation, not animation, some numerical simulations in order to understand the differences between the analytical Jacobian and the geometric Jacobian that we are going to introduce now. Okay, position error, no problem, because the position is simply desired position minus the current position. And the time derivative is actually the linear velocity, so with the physical meaning of linear velocity. Okay? But what if I consider Euler angles? Okay, Euler angles, I have my desired Euler angles, so three numbers. And I compute the Euler angles from the current configuration. Then I take the derivative and I use it in the first of the algorithms that we saw today. Q dot is equal to the inverse of the analytical Jacobian. And this is exactly what we saw, but separated in linear orientation part. So x dot desired plus KE. Now, what will be the movement of the robot in this case? The phi dot desired is not the angular velocity, it's the time derivative of the orientation representation. Its geometric movement is unclear, and we will see later on what does it mean unclear. Let me say, is not what you will consider as intuitive. Okay, so it's not intuitive, let me say. By the way, I always need to compute the rotation. Why? Because in order to write the error, I need the current Euler angles. And I do compute the Dirac kinematics. The Dirac kinematics gives me the homogeneous transformation matrix. From that, I extract the rotation matrix. And from the rotation matrix, I can extract Euler angles. It's not very convenient. Okay. As I said, the computational issues are less and less important. So we do have enough powerful to do most of our computations. But the intuition of the movement is indeed very important. We will skip axis angle, okay? We are not going to make exercise feeding back the axis angle representation. So let us skip axis angle. This is axis angle. And we will now introduce the possibility to use the unit quaternion in order to feedback the orientation. Okay. Now, unit quaternion. I do know that the rotation error, so R tilde, can be obtained by properly composing the desired rotation and the current, the actual and effective rotation. This formula here is simply the rotation that I need to go from the current to the desired. So it's the same conceptually is like I say P desired minus P, okay, for the orientation. So it's exactly what we already see. What is the rotation that I need to go from the current to the desired? This one. So what is the displacement that I need to go from the current position to the desired? Is PD minus P. So this is the orientation concept for the error. I do know that the quaternion allows us to compute the quaternion related to R tilde without computing the rotation matrices, but by proper composition of the desired and the end effector quaternion. And I can extract the vector part of the quaternion. So this one here is the vector part of this one. Now, I don't care about its symbolic representation. I just implement this one with a one-liner code of MATLAB. What is important is that I do know how to compute it, okay? And I can use this error in a very simple and intuitive formula where I simply have that the error, okay, multiplied by gain is added to the angular velocity. We should pay attention that now this is the physical angular velocity, okay? So omega desired is the physical. With the physical meaning of angular velocity. If I implement this algorithm for the orientation part, I do have just multiplying left multiplying by J, the geometric Jacobian, I do have this expression, and this expression is very convenient because it means that I have the orientation error and the physical angular velocity error that are aligned, let me say. We will see in next slides the meaning of this property. For the Euler angle representation, I did have the time derivative of the Euler angles without physical meaning. Now I'm reaching a feedback with respect to the physical angular velocity. And this will change totally the behavior of our end effector. We will not make the stability analysis for the orientation part, but just as a curiosity, still is a Lyapunov-based stability analysis. Okay, so we will not do it. The page is here just to show you another way. And also this page is also a page that you will need it just in case you are going to make the master thesis with us. And if you need to control a quadrotor or the underwater vehicle or the humanoids, it's better to have the angular velocity with respect to the quadrotor instead of with respect to the base frame. So this is just one page where there is only this plus in red, because it's the only difference with respect to the previous one. But if you try to control a quadrotor and you don't change this plus, something dramatic will happen. Okay. So we are not going to go into detail of this one. We are not going into detail of the stability analysis, but let me show you the differences of the two feedback, the feedback with the unit quaternion and the feedback with the Euler angles. Okay? With the analytical Jacobian and the Euler angles. Okay. Let me make this example. It's very simple. Now, I would like you to reply. In the left-hand side, I have the initial orientation for the end effector, for an underwater vehicle, for a aerial vehicle, whatever, okay? This is the initial orientation. Now here, on the right-hand side, I have the initial orientation and I draw the final desired orientation, okay? According to you, what is the intuitive motion that you will expect from this end effector, for example? During the transient, what do you expect the end effector to do? Let me pose the question in another way. X, Y, Z. Okay, this is initial. The final is 45 around Z. So I close. This is the final. Okay? Now, the transient, what is your expectation? Something like that, mathematically, is reaching the final orientation. Is it something that you would consider appropriate or intuitive from an orientation part? Initial, I make something like that, and final. Is it okay or not? Final, sorry. Is it okay or not? Following any intuitive description of intuitive concept of what could be okay or not. In other words, what is the shortest rotation to go from here to here? If I make the initial and final, they do have in common one unit vector. This is made on purpose because it's the most clear way to show this issue. Let me show you next plot. Now, I implemented the two algorithms, one with the Euler angles and analytical Jacobian, and the other with the unit quaternion and angular velocity. And here I show you the result of the simulation. And I just anticipate you that from those plots, you will not understand the issue, okay? Because those are the mathematical solutions. They're very nice. Quaternion, initial quaternion, final quaternion. Quaternion error goes to zero. Okay, nice. Quaternion error is a three-dimensional vector. It's only the vector part of the quaternion error. Nice. Euler angle, z, y, z, initial and final. And this is the error in z, y, z. Zero. Nice. From those plots, I cannot understand what is the issue. Okay. Let me try to draw the angular velocities. And those are the components of the angular velocities in the two cases. Now, maybe here I could start having an int. Let me explain the lines. With the blue lines, we have the angular velocity, so the physical angular velocity, corresponding to the z, y, z case. And we see three lines. With the red line, I reported the physical angular velocity with the quaternion feedback. And I see, let me say, two lines. Actually, I see only one line because there are three lines. Two are zero, and the other is different from zero. What's going on? This is my initial orientation. X is the same, initial and final, okay? I'm intentionally closing my hands, initial and final. The angular velocity, the physical angular velocity of the unit quaternion has only one component. This component. The angular velocity represents the direction around which I'm rotating. Okay? This is the unit quaternion rotation. Here I have three components different from zero. What does it mean? We will see later some snapshot to understand it. It means that this guy is making some movement also around not x direction. So let me first show you the snapshot with the quaternion case. X remains the same, and my frame is nicely aligning with the desired one. Okay? Nice. This is the ZYZ case. I'm losing the physical meaning. The angular velocity is not aligned with X, and so my movement is something like that, and that goes here, okay? I'm rotating around a direction that is always not always the same, so it's difficult to make it with ends. But, and this is the side view of the movement with the Z, Y, Z. I don't have the physical meaning of my, okay? So this is the reason why I do like quaternions. This is the reason why we will implement all kind of representation in exercise. But when we do work with the real robot, we implement quaternions. Okay? When we need to represent the orientation to the user, we cannot use quaternions because they are not intuitive. This is the reason why here I see three lines, because I have the three components of the angular velocity. Now, just the time evolution of the errors, they are very nice. From this plot, I cannot notice anything interesting. That exponential, you see? Nice exponential related to the inverse of the gains that you selected in the control law. So everything is very nice. From here, I cannot understand the issue. One int for your project. Quaternion is dimensionless, okay? And ZYZ is radian. It's just one int. Okay. So now I understand why I do need to implement quaternion. Actually, it could be a little bit boring from the conceptual aspect. From the practical aspect, you will not see any difference because it's just one line. You compute the error in a certain way. Instead of having desired minus actual, you implement this one. But you write the code once and that's done. So it's computationally no difference. It's conceptually, yes, the orientation is a totally new concept for you. Maybe it's not totally new for the mechanical engineering student. It depends from your career in undergraduate classes. But for students from information topics, it's totally new, okay? It was new also for me in the beginning. Okay. I have another issue with orientation, and then we will move to some comparison, numerical comparison of the algorithms, okay? Because basically, I mean, those are the families of inverse kinematics algorithms that we are going to use. And we spend a lot of time on this one. Now, there is a strange phenomenon that can arrive when you implement algorithm to control the orientation of a rigid body, so the end effector, or for example, aerial robot underwater, even with autonomous car, if you don't pay attention to what I define as the 2π rotation issue, that is something that I show you first the video of. Okay, this is the video of the exam. I think two years ago, one student belonging to the class of 2 years ago. Now, you should pay attention to this one, okay? The exercise was to provide a certain movement at the end effector in a kind of screw-like movement. If you have a look here, is it moving? Sorry, I haven't noticed. Ah, okay. I show you the proper movement. So that's why. Okay. Let's see the wrong movement. Screw-like movement. Here you can notice that it starts moving and then make a kind of 2π rotation, come back, 2π rotation, okay? So what was the issue with this controller? And of course now this is the correct one. It just had to make a proper rotation. Here start the movement, a proper rotation of in a screw-like movement by advancing a little bit. So this is the desired movement for this project. Now, what is the problem? Well, the problem is the so-called 2π rotation issue, and it arrives when you are working with the desired rotation close to minus pi. So this frame here is the base frame or the inertial frame. Now you have this desired orientation, and what happened in those two situations if you compute the error x1 and x2, no matter what is the representation in roll pitch AO, desired is minus 175, 1 is 160, 2 is 170. Well, if you compute the error with respect to x1, so if your current configuration is in x1, this is the error, and so it means that your controller correctly tries to go from 1 to desired, okay, in that direction. However, if you compute the error by only applying the formula, the controller tries to go on the desired orientation from making the long rotation, okay? It's a very simple way to handle it. When we will arrive at a moment where you will be more confident, in case I will tell you how to do it. It's just two lines to handle. Basically, you compute both the error and you go in the shorter direction. Okay, that's basically, it's a very, very simple way. Okay, now we studied a little bit of algorithms. You will spend some time in implementing them, and we will go incrementally, first position only, then position orientation without quaternion on a planar base, and then the six-dimensional problem with all the degrees of freedom, building an incremental code. Okay, so we will spend some time in those concepts. So now let us see a comparison. I'm interested in the position orientation of a trilink planar, so position x, y, and orientation phi. This is the direct kinematics, so I don't need to write it down, but since it's very simple, I can do it. The link is half meter for all three. The analytical Jacobian is this one. Actually, in this case, the geometric Jacobian is the same because I can only rotate around Z. Okay, so here I'm not interested in the orientation part. The initial configuration of the robot is this one. It means that my initial end effector position is this one with the orientation zero. And this is my desired trajectory for the position and desired trajectory for the orientation. So a sinusoidal trajectory that after 4 seconds stays constant. Okay. Simulations have been run in MATLAB with the simplest Euler numerical integration, and with delta t is equal 1 millisecond. Just to make it clear, what we are simulating is only the orange loop. This is assumed to be perfect, so there is no need to simulate it. Of course, it's not true, but for our case, it's okay. Okay, open loop inversion. Open loop means simply Q dot is equal the inverse of the Jacobian multiplied by X desired dot without feedback. Now here, I have the position error norm. Sorry, this is in Italian, but it's just one character difference with respect to the English. So position error norm. And I can notice that this error is not zero. And this is simply caused by the numerical integration. Okay, The integral of velocity is not the position. So the integral of this one is accumulating a random walking error caused by the integration, the discretization. In the end, the error stays constant. There is no way to bring it back to zero, because here, when x dot desired is equal to zero, q dot is zero, there is no feedback. Okay? For the orientation, is the same. Now, the number here is very small, but the point that I want to stress here is the qualitative behavior of the algorithm. It's not the number. Closed loop inversion. I do add KE, and this is the value of K. Now, the numbers, I mean, it depends from several factors, but here basically from the sampling time. I would like to stress the fact that here I have the same game for the position and another game for the orientation. Okay, this is the minimum clusterization that I can do of the gains. I don't select six different numbers for the general case, because position has the same physical meaning, orientation the same physical meaning. So I basically tune one gain for the position and one for the orientation. And this is what is done here. Okay? 500 is for the position and 100 for the orientation. Now, I have a joint position and the error. The error is different from zero during the transient, of course, than when t is equal 4 seconds goes to zero. And for the velocity is the same. This is the joint velocity in radian seconds, and this is the joint position in radians. Okay. Nothing dramatic, nothing to stress here. They are smooth. That's all. Closed loop inversion, redundant case, without exploiting the redundancy. I just leave the orientation free. In such a case, I only take the first two lines of the analytical Jacobian and I make the pseudo inversion. I don't make the full inversion because it's 2/3 the Jacobian. This is Q dot. Kp is this one. The error goes to zero, then it is different from zero during transient. That's fine. Okay. The orientation is totally free, so there is no error defined for the orientation because I don't have any desired orientation. Transpose base inversion, redundant case. This is the formula with this Kp. Now, Kp does not have any more the meaning of inverse of the constant time. Okay? It was a non-linear design, so the meaning is lost. This is the error, goes to zero at steady state, fine. Okay. Orientation uncontrolled. Okay. Now, closed loop case, closed loop inversion, redundant case with use of the null space. I want to maximize the manipulability measure. So this is the algorithm that I'm going to use with the second term, that is the exploitation of the redundancy. Manipulability measure is this function. I don't care at the detail of the function. The important is that I have a certain Q dot A, okay, with a certain KA. Now I run twice the simulation with and without exploitation of the redundancy. And if you can notice that the error position norm for the two cases is superimposed. I see only one line because the two lines are superimposed one each other. The redundancy is not changing the end effector behavior. The redundancy means that I'm exploiting the internal motion of the robot. It means that the end effector error is the same. The difference is here, since the two positions are a little bit different. This is the joint position for the first case, and this is the joint position with exploitation of redundancy. You can see that they're a little bit different, and actually the manipulability measure is different. In the first case, I'm totally ignoring the manipulability measure. In the second case, I'm trying to actually maximize. So in the first case, I'm trying to maximize. The solid line is the maximization of the mobility. Okay. It is a local maximization. It does not mean that my function always goes up, because this is related to the nonlinear issues related to where I am with my robot. So I can locally maximize it. I can try to implement another case with the use of the function related to the distance from the joint limit. This is my function, and the function is useful in order to define Q dot A. What is important now is to notice that the joint try to stay, the dashed line here are the limits for joint one, joint two, and joint three, and my function try to stay more or less in the center of my joint range. With joint three, this can be noticed quite nicely. Okay, so I'm exploiting the redundancy. Those are simple examples that you can find in textbook. Now, this is a suggestion to handle the variables in our class. We will come back on that when we'll arrive in our exercise. So we don't have to see the details here. And this is the pseudocode for the exercise. Every time that we are going to implement, actually this is the pseudocode also for the experiments, it's not different. Every time that I'm going to implement my kinematic controller, I need to implement basically three steps within each sampling time. I need to generate the desired end effector value. Now, this can be generated by an analytical function or an end user with a joystick, whatever. I need to have my desired end effector value. Or it can be stored in a file, and I just take one line of the file at each sampling time, whatever. I need to compute the current end effector value. It means that I need to read the joint measurement from the real hardware, if this is an experiment, or I need to compute from Coppelia, if a numerical simulation, or if it is a simulation, I already have the variable with the current joint, and from that I need to compute the direct kinematics. So, homogeneous transformation matrix. I do implement Q dot equal whatever multiplied by the error. Okay? And so I need to compute the error and then the equation. If it is a simulation, I just integrate the velocity, because I'm assuming that everything is perfect. If this is not a simulation, instead of integration, I send my reference to the hardware. And there will be another controller in charge of following my. Okay, so it's very simple. A small recap, because we have seen actually a lot of controllers, but they belong to more or less to the same family. I can use the analytical Jacobian in the tracking case. Tracking means that the desired trajectory is not constant. Redundant case. So here I use pseudo-inverse, I use the analytical Jacobian, and my error is defined as desired orientation representation minus the current one. And my desired velocity is given by the time derivative of the orientation representation. What does it change if I move from analytical to geometrical Jacobian? Well, basically, I just have to call a different Jacobian function, J, without the subscript A, and I need to compute properly the orientation error and to use the angular velocity. If I want to use the regulation case without assign a trajectory, but simply a constant configuration, well, simply the velocities are zero in the formula above. The desired velocity are zero. Okay. Of course, the gains in regulation and tracking are different. If I'm in square case, I do use the inverse instead of the pseudo-inverse in both cases. With MATLAB, this could be a useless suggestion, because with MATLAB, PIMV, if the matrix is square, actually refer to inverse of a matrix. So I can implement all the formula, all the combinations with the transpose instead of the pseudo-inverse. So this is a simple recap of the families of differential inverse kinematics algorithms that we have seen today and that we are going to implement. Okay, the difference from the practical aspect is very, very limited, because actually most of the time is 2-3 line of code. It's no major issue. Okay, do you have any lecture at 12 here? What about you? No? Okay, so let us see two videos and conclude here. Those are experiments made in the lab and actually published recently in some conferences. This is the work basically of Paolo Di Lillo, that is a postdoc working with us in the lab. And those represent well advanced version of a kinematic controller exploiting redundancy. Okay, so now it is exploiting the redundancy in order to take into account the joint limit, a virtual wall, the obstacle avoidance with respect to a man, and now the arm is asked to stay constant, but to avoid the person. So it means that when the person approach, the arm stay away from it for a safety reasons. And so you can see that what Paolo is doing is exploiting all the control objective, trying to put in difficulty the robot, and the robot is exploiting the redundancy in order to control all the obstacle avoidance is made with respect to shoulder, elbow, and wrist. The person is identified with the RGBD camera, so only few points of the person are considered. In this case, I think only the end. Okay, and then the virtual wall are obstacles. So
obviously is a little bit different from what you will study, but conceptually is an extension. Now, this is another work basically made by Paolo. What we have done, and of course it's just for curiosity, is to finish the lesson, is not something that you are going to do, is to provide a lot of control objectives, not only the end effector, and to clusterized them in safety, operational, and optimization tasks. And for example, here we do have the joint limit and end effector position. The plot here are quite small, but we demonstrate that without taking into account those limits, we make a big error in the end effector trajectory. If we properly take, and this is the big error that you can verify here in the top down, the deviation from the desired one, if we add the optimization task in a proper priority order, so there is a lot of mathematics here, we can optimize everything, and you can see here the blue line that is following more closely the dashed red line, because we are exploiting the internal motion in order to follow the desired trajectory. Okay, so this was just to conclude with the curiosity of something that we have done, or we are doing, because we are working a lot on those aspects in our lab. Okay, do you have any